talking about self-reliance, that takes me to my next question, which is on Make in India. Dr. Pandey, the Ministry of Defense has cleared around 111 military projects worth around 1.78 lakh crore rupees. Mm. Clearly, the focus of Make in India initiative is on defense production.
Mm. Yes. Defense is one of the major areas because of the large public procurement attached to it. But I would like to add that the licensing that we were talking about is only a very, very small part of the whole chain of manufacturing and supply. And the real problems actually lie post grant of license in actual manner. There are technology barriers and access to key technologies, access to critical raw materials. Because at the end of the day, defense systems, whether it is weapon systems, defensive system, electronic surveillance system, all these areas, they require very high degree of performance standards, high degree of quality and assurance to the armed forces. And therefore, their trials are also very, very rigorous. The materials have to be heavily ruggedized. So that is a big struggle. It is one thing for any industrialist to come forward and say, I can do it. But the same product that in civilian market will pass with a test level X would require maybe 3X, 5X, 10X level of testing and robustness to pass through the defense customer. So therefore, there are challenges in defense manufacturing, and that's part of the learning for the businesses to manage.
So challenges are there, but there's also a very important point, which is of FDI inflows. Mm. Now, according to the rules, FDI is allowed up to 49% in the defense sector through the approval route. Mm. Now, the government has informed Parliament that between 2014 and 2018, there has been FDI inflow of around 1.12 crore rupees. Mm. What measures are required to push FDI inflows in the defense sector?
You see, from the point of view of the Ministry of Commerce or DIPP, it is only the enabling policy framework, whether you are allowing in an automatic route or through a permission route and up to what extent. Beyond this, as I said, just in case of procurement, post-investment, fructifying those investments is the struggle that the investor has to go through. To what extent he can find competent partners, industry partners. There are a host of other implementation issues, getting proper sites, land, the ground level clearances. And that is why what in the department we are doing is to generally improve the ease of doing business environment, reducing the clearances, time taken in those. And those results have shown that the way we have jumped from 142 to 77 in World Bank ranking. But 77 still means we have far from top 10 to top 5. So there is still a lot of work to do. If we only focus on what has not been done, we would always be discouraged. So it's a work in progress. We wish to bring it down further from 77 to 50, 40, 10.
I'll take that to Brigadier Dhaya. Brigadier Dhaya, we are talking about. Yes, Mr. Badrinath, you wanted to pitch in.
Please. I have a point to make here.
Yes.
In the sense that there are two big lobbies in the defense establishment here. One, who completely want reliance on the imports. Second issue is the industrial capabilities are just, being built right now in this country for defense-related equipment and huge defense ships are like, the warships or the aerospace that you're talking about and all that. Third is the technology aspect. But this is one part of it. Second is there is always a friction between the import lobbies as well as the domestic manufacturing lobbies. And that will show up in a big way, both on the policy side as well as meeting the requirements. How do you balance out the requirements of the forces as well as, what you want here in this country and the commercial interests?
Right.
We're talking about
domestic production. Yeah. Brigadier Dhaya, how important is indigenization of defense production for force multiplication in our defense preparedness and reconnaissance?
You see, indigenization is absolutely necessary if you want to really want to be a big defense power. Our role globally is increasing because of our rising economy. Our diplomatic footprint will rise. Call on us to provide, to be a net security provider in the region.
Yes.
Will also, of course, go up simultaneously. It's a natural sine qua non for that. For that, we need to be a strong military power, not only to look after what Mr. Badrinath was saying, our immediate threat from north and west, but also when we are called upon to help someone else at a greater distance. Now, in no country, only public sector has been able to meet the defense requirements.
Absolutely.
In fact, any country which relies more on the private sector does better. You see, there are certain automatic advantages for a private sector. They can negotiate quietly, they can negotiate fast, take quick decisions and all that. In the government, machinery moves at its own speed. And one person makes a noting which is a little contradictory to what is being talked about. Nobody has the power thereafter to remove it, because otherwise that guy will be hauled up subsequently, either because of anti-corruption things and all that, or in front of the parliament. So as a result of which, it's only the private sector which makes quick decisions, can forge alliances or partnerships for getting technology, can hire people from anywhere. You remember a thing that was talked about a lot when Soviet Union was breaking up, and scientists were available for hire in the advanced technology field also. We couldn't hire anybody because some people in the ministry said, oh, how can you pay them more than what I get? Now, this is a typical thing that happens with the governments. Otherwise, we would have taken a march over everybody else in rocketry, in designing engines, and in many fields. But we couldn't do it just because the members of the government at that time said, no, you can't pay them more than us. Now, similar thing, private sector, on the other hand, would not mind. Mr. Vivek Lal, who was hired from US by Mukesh Ambani's firm that time, and they wanted to get into it, they paid him unbelievable sums.
So we're talking about greater private sector participation in defense production.
Greater power, yes, absolutely.
Right. It's necessary. I'll take that to you, Mr. Badrinath. According to the Draft Defense Policy 2018, the government has vision of catapulting India into top 5 defense producers in the world. How does India fire up defense production by using cutting-edge technology?
See, cutting-edge technology is a big issue in the entire defense industry opening up. One, the foreign investment that you are talking or seeking. Second is promoting our own domestic industry that which can contribute. For both the things to happen, technology is going to be the key. What kind of technology? And mostly, the technology gets outdated very quickly, especially in the digital technologies that we are talking about. And mostly now you are going to have digital warfare. So if digital warfare is going to be the front, then you are not going to sit back and say that, okay, I will fight the 1962 war again. No, that's not the issue. Point here is that one, and also these technologies are not easily available.
Right.
But second issue here is, for some reason or the other, both the domestic industry is not in sync with the DRDO. The Defense Research Development Organization has huge potential and it has done a lot, but still they would like to go for imported technology. And let us, on this forum, let's accept that, the payoffs are a way of, what happens in this industry, especially in the defense industry. And because when we had lots of licensing, always they would push for imports. When the imports were pushed for, always there is a give and take. So this is what happened in the 70s, 80s and 90s. And now what is happening is that since you opened up, one, yes, I agree with him that Brigadier Dahiya, that we have made a very modest beginning. I completely agree. But this is the right way to go about, actually. You open up more, make it freer. See, business environment has to be very free. Only then the best potential can be actually realized. For instance, Tatas can definitely make aerospace engineering engines. They can do it, but for several reasons, the joint venture with the Airbus is not going through.
So a step in the right direction has been taken up. Dr. Pandey, two very specific questions. The government is eyeing a turnover of around 1.7 lakh crore rupees in the defense sector in the next couple of years. Mm-hmm. And according to a report, even a cut of 20 to 25% in the imports could create around 1 lakh highly skilled jobs. So what are the vistas that are being opened for the MSMEs in the sectors? And also, what kind of impact of this move do you see on job creation?
No, any effort of opening industrialization for and make in India will automatically lead to more of manufacturing jobs. That there cannot be two opinions about that. The key challenge is particularly in this defense area of manufacturing. Before any investor puts investment in creating new facilities, new production facilities, which require huge investment, is the assurance of a reasonable order in the air. Unlike a civilian market where a white goods manufacturer forecasts the demand coming for ACs, fridge, TV from the general population, it is very difficult for a defense manufacturer to estimate how many orders he can expect in next 5 years, 10 years, and how much that can be amortized in the investment upfront that he has to make.
Right.
So it is that delicate balance that has to be addressed in proper financial structuring of the
absolutely. Record. So the balance has to